let's start with, you know, from the just the very beginning of what people think when they meet you and they hear your name. You are one of the last human beings to step foot off the moon. When you look at pictures of the moon and you think back to that experience, what goes through your head all these years later still?
Well, it was a great opportunity. I get to talk about it all the time. And some people ask me, do I ever dream about it? And I guess the answer has to be no, because I'm talking about it all the time. It doesn't seem to be something that happens. But people are amazingly interested in space. And yes. I guess often wondering why in the world have we pulled back. And we'll just wait and see. Maybe we haven't in the long term. I don't think we have. And so,
what is the most common question you find people want to ask you when they meet you and they know who you are? What is the, is there a common question you get over and over?
Well, to some degree, that's dependent on age.
Okay.
But I would say the most common question of older kids, including adults, is what was it like?
Yeah.
And everybody wants to share in the experience the best they can, and that's the hardest thing to do, because it's one of those experiences you have in life that is unique to yourself, and your reactions to it are unique. And if you can imagine those experiences that you've had, and I hope you've had many, where you have thought about it, you've talked to others about it, family, friends, but when the event actually takes place, it's more than you ever could have anticipated. Whether standing on the rim of the Grand Canyon or right. some other experience like that in your life, the first child or any child being born, that's the kind of experience that I think those of us that had the privilege and honor of going to the moon have had.
Do you remember the first emotion you felt when you stepped on the moon for the very first time?
Oh, I can. I said, because my foot went out from under me. It slipped on a rock. And I said, oh, don't fall. I said to myself, don't fall.
And that was,
so
your
that
first
was the first emotion.
That's
and
great.
You have to realize that initially, we're working right around the Lunar Module Challenger. And this was a very familiar machine for us. So we had worked with it. Our training encompassed it. And so the vision you have out of your helmet is still mm-hmm. something that's very familiar to you. And you haven't had a chance to move away from the spacecraft and actually take in the scenes around you. We had landed in a valley deeper than the Grand Canyon. The Valley of Torres Letro on the moon is one of the deepest valleys in the solar system. It is really a magnificent place to see once you have a chance to move away from the spacecraft. The mountains are over 6,000 and 7,000 feet high. There's brilliantly illuminated by the sun, but they're against a black sky, a blacker than black sky. And all of it is, and of course, if you look up over the southwestern mountain in this part of the moon, you'll see the Earth. It's always hanging in the same place in the sky. So the whole experience, visual experience, is really quite remarkable.
And you mentioned seeing the Earth, and I was going to ask you this a little while later, but you took one of the most iconic pictures of all time of Earth. At that moment when you did you think, this is a spectacular view I'm getting here, this is definitely a once-in-a-lifetime capture, or did you just simply take it and stumble upon the moment? How did the famous picture come about?
That's a little bit of a story
yeah.
there. I grew up in the Silver City area of New Mexico, mm-hmm. and my father introduced me to meteorology. And so we, as a child, spent a lot of time talking about weather, trying to forecast the next storm that would come through and things like that. And so I carry that with me, really, for a long time. I've always been interested in weather patterns.
Okay.
And when I knew that I'd have three and a half days on the way to the moon, in which there would be some downtime, I decided to have an actual observing program in my mind for looking back at the Earth. And as the Earth rotated, I would be, every 24 hours, I would be able to see whether my forecasts wow. of weather patterns, southern hemisphere weather patterns, were any good or not. And so I spent 3.5 days doing that, and the picture of the full Earth with mm-hmm. Africa mm-hmm. Fully illuminated is the first of the pictures I took to document my weather observations.
So the blue marble, that photo, the blue marble, that there was a lot of thought that went into it.
Oh, there
and
was.
And a lot of planning.
Yeah, very, very definitely. And okay. There's a series of pictures that will take you see the Earth change its weather image all the way to the moon. So that was the first of them. And if you look carefully at it, you'll see that there's a typhoon or a hurricane going ashore on India. There are these beautiful arrowhead-shaped fronts that are circling Antarctica. It really shows you a lot about the weather of the Earth.
And you're still excited all these years later. I can see it in your face. You grew up in Silver City, as you said. So what were you like in high school? Were you interested in weather, but were you a straight-A science student? What were you like?
Well, I was interested in weather. Okay. I was a science student. I was a nerd, I'm sure, okay. But I also played football and worked out at track and things like that. So I took part in student government, so I tried to do everything I could. That's been really something that's either, I don't think it's planned, but it's happened in my life. Mm-hmm. I've been able to do a lot of different things all through my life, and it's been a very, very enjoyable experience.
In high school, they call that well-rounded. So that's perfect for going off to college. You do a little bit of everything. That's good. You're a nerd, but you do sports, and you know. So tell me what happened right after high school.
Well, I had looked at a lot of different universities to go to, okay. But I was doing so many other things that when I received these packets of application forms, they were all 8-10 pages, and I don't have time to do this. And the Caltech form was one page, okay. Two sides of one page.
Easy.
And so I fill out a Caltech form, and it happened to my father, who was a geologist, okay. Knew some of the people at Caltech and thought they were good folks, and it was a good place to go. So I just ended up applying to Caltech, and fortunately had an opportunity to get a really outstanding education in science and engineering at Caltech, and also the opportunity through an advisor, Ian Campbell, to apply for a Fulbright Fellowship mm-hmm. to Norway, which turned out to be a fantastic experience as well. And then after that, went on to Harvard for a doctorate.
Any point in that early part of your life, did it ever cross your mind that you wanted to be an astronaut? Kids dream about that all the time. They dress up as astronauts for Halloween. It's a vision they have. They talk about it in school. But is that really something?
I didn't have that opportunity because there weren't any astronauts during that time. I read science fiction and of course was had thought very briefly about space travel and a science fiction point of view. But the first real exposure I had to thinking about space was when I was in Norway and the first artificial satellite of the Earth was launched by the then Soviet Union, Sputnik 1. And when I returned from my field area to Oslo, the University of Oslo, the international student community there was very, very intrigued by this. And you could tell that space was going to be something important to the future of humankind as well as the future of our country.
I mean, at that time in everyone's life, it was just a dream. Like you said, it wasn't something that was going on, space travel. So to think about that from, you know, your perspective, you have the science background, but it probably still seemed like, will it ever happen?
Well, I didn't think about it at all, okay. Even though some of my student friends from Caltech had gone into the missile industry and things like that. It didn't really occur to me that I might apply to become an astronaut until the announcement of opportunity to do so appeared on a bulletin board where I was working in Flagstaff, Arizona. Wow. And I looked at it and said, well, about 10 seconds of thought, and said, why not raise your hand and volunteer? So I volunteered.
That is incredible. So you literally saw it in an ad.
Yeah, NASA the National Academy of Sciences had sent out an advertisement saying they're looking for applications from scientists.
Right.
And it seemed like a logical thing to do. I had known a few years before the National Academy had said the first person on the moon should be a hard rock geologist. Well, that's what
there
I was.
Go. Sure.
And so I said, why not? Let's see where it goes.
And from that moment, you saw the ad from NASA. You raised your hand. You're interested. You're more than qualified. No one's ever done this before. What was the process like moving forward from there?
Well, the National Academy ran the selection process initially. And they had 1,400 applicants. They were required to take a Federal Aviation Administration physical,
okay.
and that narrowed it down to about 400 applicants.
Okay.
And then they asked for more information, transcripts and things like that, and they selected 80 people to evaluate in detail with essays and,
okay.
and things like that. There weren't interviews at that time. And then out of that 80, 16 were selected names were selected to send to NASA for a very comprehensive physical okay. examination. That was an 8-day physical examination at Brooks Air Force Base in San Antonio. And out of that 16, and then some interviews that NASA conducted, they selected six of us to actually be the first group of scientists in the space program.
At that moment, you know, you had gone from the 1,400 to the 400, now you're down to 80, now you're making these final lists, all this testing. What were you feeling? Did you think, this is going to happen? I'm going to the moon. Or were you still thinking, this is still very rigorous, very competitive, not quite sure how it would turn out?
More of the latter. It was very competitive. Okay. There were some really fantastic people who had applied. Not as many as I thought might, but nevertheless, it was a very competitive process, and one didn't have any idea whether they were going to make it or not.
Right.
What NASA may have seen in the physical, that eliminated several people, and probably almost eliminated me. I don't know, when you're almost 30 years old, you know, you're very different than an 18-year-old, and the first requirement was to go to pilot training, so
okay.
you had to be qualified for jet pilot training. And with that, however, Randy Lovelace of the Lovelace group mm-hmm. here in mm-hmm. Albuquerque was NASA's, on a consulting basis, was NASA's chief flight surgeon. And he intervened in my case and said, you're fine, you should be fine. And actually, I got a phone call from Randy Lovelace before I ever got any notice from NASA
oh, wow.
saying, you're going to be in. So that was remarkable. I never had a chance to meet Dr. Lovelace. Okay. He died about 6 months later in that plane crash, or as a result of a plane crash.
Right. Now, once you got that phone call, you were one of the six. You had made it. Who was the first person you told? What did you do?
Well, of course, I called my parents, and, mm-hmm. and they weren't too sure that it was a good idea. But they,
yeah,
they
were sounds a little scary, but exciting. Yeah.
Me.
And from that moment you were chosen to the time you left, what was that training period like? How long did it last? What else did you have to do besides the pilot training?
The first thing was jet pilot training.
Okay.
I became a T-38 pilot. A couple years later, became a helicopter pilot. Everybody had to qualify in helicopters as well. But then it was a process of learning all the things that go into space flight, orbital mechanics, the engineering side of things, getting familiar with the spacecraft, with computers, with the process of actually flying in space. And then in early 1970, mm-hmm. I was assigned to the backup crew of Apollo mm-hmm. 15. And that's when the real training goes. And for 15 months, you learn how to fly a mission. And you get even more deeply involved in the details, the engineering details of the spacecraft and of the flight operations necessary for these missions. And then immediately after Apollo 15 assignment, I transitioned into Apollo 17 and went through the whole cycle again, but focused on a different place on the moon.
Do you feel like you enjoyed that training time, or was it very stressful to the point where you questioned what you were?
The training was stressful, but it was very enjoyable because okay. you're competing all the time with yourself, and it turns out the crew is always competing with the flight controllers to see if they can see in the computer simulations the problems that the simulation supervisor has introduced as part of the training process. And most of our training was to try to solve problems that might happen to us. None of those problems ever actually happened, but they had problems, and knowing how on each mission how to deal with the concept of a problem was very important.
And when you were on the spaceship in transit going there, do you remember what that felt like physically and emotionally, just getting there?
Well, physically it was being exposed to weightlessness for the first time.
Right.
And that is an interesting experience. Everybody reacts somewhat differently to it. It's a very individualistic thing. In my case, I felt like I was swimming, but with no water.
Okay.
If you can imagine that. Trying to go to sleep the first night, I finally got relaxed enough that I realized just before I started to doze off that I had lost perception of my arms and my legs. The muscles had gotten so relaxed that they were no longer activating nerves that told you where your arms and legs were. All you had to do was think about moving them and they'd come back.
That's incredible.
So I spent about half an hour turning my arms and legs on and off.
Yeah, just to make sure they were still okay.
Yeah, and you can do that here on Earth if you are willing to relax in warm water, about body temperature water.
Okay.
Gradually that will happen, but it's not something you normally experience. I'd never experienced before.
Right, so that's interesting you say that. So to simulate that feeling, that would be kind of the closest we could get to that.
Yeah, I think, imagine swimming in water without any water.
Yeah.
That's it. And then on the moon, in 1/6 gravity, imagine walking around on a giant trampoline. You're just as strong, you have the same muscle strength.
Sure.
But you don't weigh as much. You only weigh 1/6. And even with the spacesuit, which weighed 370 pounds, you divide that by 6, and that's about 61, 62 pounds.
And how long did it take to get there? How many?
It took 3.5 days.
3.5 days.
To get the moon. We spent 1 day in lunar orbit. Mm-hmm. You're always checking. We were Earth orbit for 2 orbits.
Okay.
But you're always checking these systems to make sure everything's okay, and that you can take the next step. And that was the reason the Apollo program was so successful, is that we did it. It was planned to do things in stages to make sure everything was working right.
And how often did you talk to your fellow astronauts, or what was going on in transit? Was there a lot of conversation, or?
Most of everything that you're going on is related to the flight plan, to the checklist, things like that. And of course, when we had some relaxing time, chatting about what the Earth looked like at various points. But it was pretty much businesslike all the way. It had to be. I mean, you had to always keep in mind that all of a sudden communications might cease with the Earth, and you're going to have to run the spacecraft not only to survive that, but to get back home.
Did that ever make you nervous, just that idea that you were going to be going where you were going to be going, you know, one of the first? Was there a fear, or did that not exist for you?
I don't think it existed for anybody, because the training was so rigorous, and you were confident that you could handle anything, believe me.
Yeah.
And all the way from learning to fly jet aircraft to helicopters to flying spacecraft, you develop this rigorous approach to being ready for anything.
And I
don't think there's any example of where that wasn't true with any of the astronauts, including the Apollo 13 emergency, which was very serious.
Now, you say that it was businesslike. So once you arrived on the moon, what were your missions going to be, or what was your mindset at that time? What did you want to accomplish when you were there? What were you thinking of looking for?
Our flight plan for Apollo 17 was much more open for the lunar surface activities than the previous flight plans were, even though we had trained and made a point of training the pilots to be pretty good geologists.
Right.
They didn't have the experience base that I did, and so we kept the Apollo 17 lunar surface flight plan as open as we could, so I would have a chance, when we got to a particular place that we had planned to go, that I'd have a chance to look around and say, yeah, this is probably the best approach to getting the samples that we want to have here at this point, based on my experience. And that's why I was there. That's why I was on the mission.
That was your expertise. Now, the discovery of orange soil, that's been talked about a lot. What was the significance of that?
Well, it was part of that whole process of examining the area around this little crater we call Shorty Crater, about an 80-meter diameter crater, and one which we thought we might see some volcanic stuff, but it was a remote possibility, but it was part of the pre-mission thinking. And I was walking up to the edge of the crater and noticed that there was this orange tint to the soil that I was walking on. And I started to dig into that soil and found this bright orange ash is what it was. Mm-hmm. It turned out to be volcanic ash. I didn't know at the time because it was so fine. I couldn't see it. It was much finer than you could see with your eye. But it was different. It was very different, and it immediately brought to mind the colorful rocks we see here in New Mexico that are around our volcanoes. And you think, well, maybe that's an alteration as a result of some volcanic activity. Well, it was certainly the result of volcanic activity, but explosive volcanic activity that had occurred 3.5 billion years ago. And this just happened to be protected until that little crater exposed it, and we found it on Apollo 17.
Was there anything during your time on the moon that you were able to bring back just for yourself, something special that you'll always have that no other human has from the moon?
The special things that I have are memories. Everything else is really the something that the taxpayer paid for and owns, and it's mostly in the Smithsonian now. So, no, that my benefit really are memories.
Looking ahead to today, space exploration, where it is now, just in the last several weeks, there's been talk about water flowing on Mars, what that potentially means. A lot of people talking about there is life on Mars. Could there be? Do you believe life exists on Mars?
Well, I think it's possible. Yeah. Mars probably went through, based on everything we know, and I've written papers on this, about the same environment that the Earth did early in Martian history. Then it's a small planet, and it started to lose its atmosphere, and that whatever had been happening in terms of the creation of life on Mars by various processes, that probably was turned off, although there is a possibility that there is a zone underneath the surface, and it varies with latitude on Mars, that where water is stable, and that zone is what we call geologically stable over a vast amount of time. And it could be that very simple life forms will exist at that interface between water and ice at depth. But again, it's going to take some drilling to find out, and probably take some real human exploration to find out.
So when we ask the question, is there life on Mars, you're saying, yes, possibly simple life forms.
Yeah, it would be very simple, very simple.
Okay, do you think we are where we should be as a country in space exploration? Are we where, are we behind a little bit? Have we lost it in the last 10 years or so? Or what are your thoughts on where we're going?
Well, NASA's done some remarkable things, as everybody knows, the landing of various spacecraft on Mars, the Curiosity now, and the Spirit and Opportunity exploration is just remarkable. There are still, there's a satellite around the moon called the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. They're still very active. We're gaining a vast amount of new information about the moon that we can integrate into what we found with the samples that the astronauts collected. All of that has been extremely positive and has advanced our understanding of the early history of the Earth remarkably. That's why the moon is important scientifically. It records the early history of the solar system, something we can't really see here on Earth because the Earth is so dynamic, geologically speaking. But Mars, you have to remember that in spite of everything else we've done, that we haven't really been active in deep space. And that, I think, is the real challenge for the United States. It's a geopolitical challenge as well as a scientific and engineering challenge, is that we start to become active again in deep space. It's a little bit like the hiatus that we had between Lewis and Clark exploring the northwestern part of the of North America, and the hiatus that occurred after that before we really started to do the pioneering. And that, you have to remember, those things happen. We go in cycles. Neil Armstrong used to talk very eloquently about the cycles of human history, or at least of American history. And that's important to remember, that we will have these pauses, but then we have to get started again. And it's very important that we get started because of geopolitical considerations.
So in many ways, we're still just scratching the surface of what's out there.
Oh, no question about it. If you just look at the moon itself, we've only explored a very small part, or not even an area half the size of the United States. So it's there's the far side of the moon we haven't explored with humans yet. We have a lot of remote sensing information about the far side, but we've never gone down there and put our nose to the rocks and actually collected samples.
And from a size perspective, that really does help, I think, for everyone to understand when you say that it's only half the size of the United States in terms of what's been explored there.
Yeah, that's right. And with just a few spots, just imagine half the United States,
right,
and putting six different dots on that half, right, and going down there, collecting some samples, and how much would we know about the United States? Well, we'd know a lot because we're very clever people, but you don't know what you don't know.
But very little in the grand scheme of what it is. Exactly. What are your thoughts on Spaceport America? A lot of political controversy with it. It's run into a lot of problems. What do you think? It's exciting that it's here in our state.
Very exciting that it's here. It has tremendous, I think, potential for the future. We're just going to have to wait and see.
Okay.
And see if the customers come, or see if new customers can't be found who would use a runway in southern New Mexico. I mean, there are a lot of uses of that runway in addition to space travel. It's going to be a question of seeing how things work out.
Okay.
It's hard to predict right now.
Now, you also went from science to politics, and it all does tie in at times. And being in Washington and seeing how things work firsthand as a U.S. Senator representing New Mexico, do you see where the controversy is? Do you see where sometimes things get held up? And do you think they're going about it the right way right now?
Well, you certainly have everything has some political component to it. And people look at their constituencies and try to do the things that we hope that they're trying to do the things that their constituencies would like them to do. And we're just going to have to wait and see on that.
And what was your inspiration to enter politics, to go down that road?
I grew up being very interested in politics. Both my mother and father were very interested, and they read a lot, and I read a lot. I read a lot of history. And so it was a fairly natural thing for me to do, that once it was clear that the career as an astronaut was dying out, at least in time, it was dying out, that I would look at what I had thought about doing many years before while I was a student at Harvard.
And bringing it to today, where all the talk now is about Mars, how far away do you think we are? How long do you think it might take for a human?
Well, I've actually written a book on that subject, and I think that if we begin to move quickly to utilize some of the resources on the moon, to settle the moon, that we can be on Mars within probably 3 decades without any question. I think you almost have to have the private sector involved, though, because there has to be a continuity, more of a continuity beyond what government is often able to do. Government funding is cyclic. It depends on so many other things. Whereas if you have an entrepreneurial private sector enterprise and it's done right, then that funding can be more or less continuous, and you can set a schedule and keep to that schedule. It's much more difficult with the government. Now, Apollo was an exception. Apollo was an exception because we had a very large, what is called a management reserve, that it was about double what had been estimated the cost would be. And that meant it was possible to deal with the unknown unknowns that come along in complex projects and maintain a schedule.
Mm-hmm.
And so Apollo did exactly what John Kennedy asked us to do, to get to the moon by the end of the decade. Unless you have that management reserve, though, it's very difficult to keep on schedule. And NASA's discovered that over the last several decades.
If you had the opportunity to go to Mars, would you have taken it?
Oh, I would. And
yeah.
My wife insists that she have a chance to go with me. So we'd have to work that out.
Yes, yeah.
But I think Mars is going to be very, very exciting. But it's going to be a very different operational enterprise. And it's not going to be like going to the moon. People have to realize that the astronauts that land on Mars will be doing it on their own. They're not going to have mission control to advise them on the way down. The communication time lag is just too great.
There's a very small group of people in the whole world that are astronauts. It's a very tight-knit group, would you say? Do you still see some of your fellow astronauts, talk to them regularly? Is there a friendship there, a bond that never dies?
Oh, there's always going to be a bond and a friendship. But we're all off doing our things, different things now, and have been for 40 years. And we see each other maybe once a year in various ways at various meetings and things like that. But there's no big reunion of Apollo astronauts.
Is there any inside baseball, things that you obviously probably can share, but things maybe that you can, little fun secrets or things that the average person doesn't know, things that no one really ever talks about that people sit back and say, oh, wow, that's an astronaut behind the scenes?
Well, there's one thing that people might be interested in, and some people may be aware of this, but because of this spacecraft that we have around the moon right now that's taking very, very high resolution images of the lunar surface, we now know that after 40 to 45 years that the American flag is still flying. And we can see the shadow of the flag on the surface. And so, and that's somewhat surprising because that's a very intense ultraviolet environment. The flag was made of nylon, is made of nylon, and the people are sort of scratching their heads. Why is that flag still flying in a sense? But we see the shadow at all six landing sites, and it's there. So Americans should be very proud of the fact that not only they went to the moon, but also that the flag is still flying.
And you're right, it's not something people talk about, and I bet you if you ask most people, they would say, no, there's no way that that can be. So that is, it's special.
It is, really. It's very amazing.
Now, you grew up in New Mexico, obviously, and why do you decide to still call this home after all this time? You've been to the moon, you've been all over the world. Why Albuquerque?
Same reason most New Mexicans stay here. It's a lovely state, it's a great, beautiful place to be, and you were always comfortable at home.
What do you like to do? What does an astronaut do for a hobby? What shows do you watch? Would we be surprised by some of the things you like to watch?
Well, I'm not a big TV watcher. Okay. I think the Big Bang Theory is very enjoyable.
Well, we don't carry that. We don't
know
that show.
I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said anything. I spend a lot of time walking. Usually have dogs. Don't have dogs right now. I do a lot of hiking in the Sandias, which is really enjoyable part. And I'm still very active in my profession, both science and engineering profession. So that keeps me busy.
And you wrote a book, and you teach. You were teaching for a while. You've taught classes.
I have had some teaching activities at the University of Wisconsin for most of a decade. That course has run its course, and now I work with them though on these trying to understand how fusion can involve the moon, fusion power, and that that still takes some time working with those folks on that. I'm still more or less on the faculty of the engineering physics department there, and we have a lot of contact.
Now, you mentioned the Big Bang Theory TV show, but when the Martian movie came out this year, people were talking about it. Does everyone ask you, hey, did you see it?
Yeah, and I haven't yet because I've been traveling so much.
Okay.
But Teresa and I are planning on seeing that probably this weekend. Everybody tells me it's a very well-done movie, so I'm looking forward to it.
So you still have interest in even the fictitious stories about Mars?
Look, any movie, you suspend disbelief when you go into a movie, right?
Yeah.
So you have to do that, but I try to just enjoy the movie and not be too critical of what of the science that they may or may not deal with.
Right. You 40 years ago, you know, it's been so long. It's been more than 40 years, but you said every year ish, you still do see fellow astronauts from time to time. Do you get together for special testing, or is there still stuff that goes on because you are an astronaut that they have to kind of follow you, monitor you throughout your life?
There are they're anniversaries, celebrations, and they're events where some number of the astronauts will show up and be there. So we see each other that way. NASA asked if we would volunteer to have our annual physicals done at the Johnson Space Center, and most of us do that. I don't know the percentage that are doing that, but I try to do that every year. Is have an annual physical. They're just trying to monitor how's our health, how are we doing, and are there any signs of anything that might be space related? To my knowledge, nothing serious has ever come up that looks like it might be space related.
And is there an idea that space travel wears on the body in a different way?
Well, long time exposure to space radiation is the big concern now. And that's, you know, going to be a concern for anyone who goes to Mars, because it's going to take at least several months, if not 9 months, to get there in what we call a minimum energy approach. But and so being exposed to space radiation of various kinds for that length of time needs to be dealt with from an engineering perspective. You need to be protected from it, and you need to know what effect that might have even at low doses for long periods of time. And the space station, the International Space Station, is telling us a great deal about that now. So we're trying to, NASA is trying to figure out just how serious is the radiation issue and what are the best engineering approaches to mitigate that issue.
What advice, it can be so involved and complex, but what basic advice would you give to people watching, or children, or people who just have a dream? They love science, they want to do something extraordinary, whether it is go to Mars or go to a different planet, but something extraordinary in the science field. What advice would you give them?
I would give them and their teachers and family the same advice, and that is to provide the opportunity for their children to get the broadest education and the best education that they possibly can. Everything is dependent on having that education of the experience, gaining experience from others, which is really what education's all about. And particularly in mathematics. Mathematics is absolutely the language of science and engineering, and it's a language more and more of almost everything that is being done in modern economy. So children really need to find ways to develop an understanding of mathematics as they would a language. And that's the main advice that I try to give.
Is there something else out there that you would love to accomplish, something that you've always dreamed of doing, that even you've done the most amazing things in the world, but there's something out there, whether it's extraordinary to you or just something basic that you haven't done that you dream of doing?
Well, I think the thing that concerns me most and that I would like to somehow continue to contribute to, and that is education. It's just fundamental, absolutely fundamental to the future of any individual and to the country as well. And we just need to make sure that here in New Mexico, as well as throughout the United States, that we realize that the education that our children are getting is not what it needs to be for a modern world, and that we have to fix that.
So teaching here in New Mexico is definitely on your list.
Well, of helping teachers and helping others and throughout New Mexico and throughout the country.